The last remaining challenge. We have anti-arrhythmic drugs, we have DC shocks, we have devices, if you know the ablation, pacemaker implantation, this bundled pacing as professor on information. We have the conventional approaches to isolate pulmonary veins, so lasso. We have the modern approaches, 3D mapping guided like CARTO or MAVIX, more complex procedures, lines, CAFE, gallium XI, e-fibness, and more complexes, but and rotors, but still atrial fibrillation is a puzzle. Something is missed. I do atrial fibrillation. I'm not a clinical cardiologist. When you do EP procedure, you should have definite targets before the procedure. As you mentioned, you say yes, you know your targets. We start to apply or analyze your proposal. The target patient, the proper indication, is it evidence-based or not? You mentioned that paroxysmal atrial fibrillation is only included in the guidelines. Paroxysmal, persistent or permanent, not included. So why you applied persistent and permanent? You don't comply to guidelines. The intra-procedural, you should define your success points, the end points. The success, the provocation, the confirmation, the numbers. In the post-procedural, the clinical outcome, freedom from symptoms. You have recurrence. Freedom from antiarrhythmic drugs. You prescribe antiarrhythmic drugs. Stop anticoagulation. You continue on anticoagulation. To resume electromechanical function of the left atrium. You may have beautiful B wave in the ECG, but non-contractile, non-functioning left atrium. The survival and prognosis. Nothing confirmed survival and prognosis. You mentioned stroke prevention, but nothing related to survival and prognosis. When you deal with SCVT, narrow complex tachycardia, with single player, you have the target, you have the Koch triangle, you have the slow pathway, you take the slow pathway, you induce junction arrest, you have successful endpoint, non-even RT, you stop antiarrhythmic drug, so it's successful procedure. When you deal with paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, also the players are limited number. You have the four pulmonary veins, the left superior, the left inferior, the right superior, the right inferior. So you are dealing with the number of players. So when you deal with chronic atrial fibrillation, or long-standing or persistent, it's like a chaotic orchestra. You cannot delineate who is producing chaos. As I mentioned, even RT is a good example of known targets before the procedure, intra-procedural and after the procedure, and the success is definite in more than 95% of the cases, maybe 98%. Atrial fibrillation is not just electric phenomenon, it's beyond electricity. Atrial fibrillation is not the same. You have atrial fibrillation with sick sinus syndrome, which deal with not ablation, you insert pacemaker. You may have atrial fibrillation in the presence of short QT syndrome. If there is family history of sudden cardiac arrest, you implant ICD. You may have atrial fibrillation with systemic substrate, like thyroid dysfunction. What does ablation do with thyroid dysfunction? You can have atrial fibrillation with rheumatic valvular heart disease. How do you ablate atrial fibrillation in the presence of rheumatic heart disease? You can have atrial fibrillation in the presence of accessory pathway. If you ablate the accessory pathway, you eliminate atrial fibrillation. So atrial fibrillation is not a single disease. It's heterogeneous pathology. It's like tend to be a syndrome rather than a disease. Sometimes you are having pulmonary vein mutations, but the patient is stable. You cannot predict at what time the triggers will initiate atrial fibrillation. What trigger the trigger? No answer. So you ablate persistent and permanent, it's a feeble indication because you have morbid anatomical substrate like dilated left atrium. Also, the definition of paroxysmal persistent and permanent is debatable. You depend on the time domain. Sometimes paroxysmal atrial fibrillation associated with huge amount of fibrosis in the left atrium, as you referred to Luta classification. So, relying on paroxysmal persistent temporal definition is not accurate definition in selection of patients. The ideal candidate should be young. The majority available in the area are the old. The optimum target is no heart disease, but the majority with structural heart disease. The majority are mildly symptomatic. The majority on medical therapy, the majority of rare issues. So the ideal patient is actually not so prevalent for ablation, I mean. Not only atrial fibrillation is the fibrillating risk, also the protocols, as you mentioned, no unified universal approach. You do BVI, you do BVEI, antral isolation, you do wide area, WACA, circumferential ablation, you do circumferential. Even the terminology is heterogeneous from one center into another center, like left atrial catheter ablation. So, not only the resin is fibrillating, but also the protocols are fibrillating. Can you define the antrum, Stefano? What is the definition of the antrum? No definition of the antrum. We ablate the antrum. You cannot delineate the exact proper place of the line. You ask the technician, the technical support, to draw the line during ablation. At what distance exactly from the orifice of the pulmonary vein you delineate from that? So it's something not accurate. So the antrum is not well defined term. The BVI we do pulmonary vein isolation is a standard technique, but persistent BVI isolation sometimes is very difficult, and you need to revisit the pulmonary veins and you find the connection. As you mentioned, the consensus about pulmonary venous isolation is still the standard of ablation of atrial fibrillation. But there are unresolved questions and issues. How you verify your isolation? The exit block is debatable. How you verify exit block? It's debatable. No standard technique to verify or consolidate your lesions. Also, revisiting, acute revisiting of the pulmonary veins is debatable. The use of isoprene adenosine for peristabasing, not standardized. So it's rather empiric and anatomic ablation. We are electrophysiologists, not electroanatomic. But the 3D mapping is 3D anatomy guided ablation. Stefano, you mimic the knees. When you tackle the atrium, when you ablate the enubilic side, when you debark the atrium, you mimic the knees. The knees is surgical procedure, has been declined by surgeons many years ago. Because it's a hell procedure. You mimic the atrium. The best of your protocols is to do good empiric lesions. You cannot justify ablation of atrial fibrillation. When you do pulmonary venous isolation, you cannot claim you did atrial fibrillation ablation. You just did pulmonary venous isolation. It's different if you do accessory ablation. You can claim that you ablated the accessory. You can claim that you eliminated the WW. But in case of atrial fibrillation, you just isolated the pulmonary veins. If you succeeded to isolate it without reprotection. The non-BV targets is real dilemma. You may find non-BV triggers, cardiac PSI, CAFEs, EFNS, rotors, right-sided SVC, SVC, CTI, and the tricuspid isthmus. So it's heterogeneous foci outside the pulmonary veins. You may be obliged to ablate the loose atrium, to remove the atrium, to get rid of the atrium. Rotology is very difficult. So we should have physiological endpoints. You should have D termination of the arrhythmia, you should have mild disability. But it's not applicable in atrial fibrillation ablation because you don't have EGM-based targets for PV isolation. You just do anatomic lines and you confirm, look, and know EGM-based ablation during the procedure. So the debate should be continued till we have reliable and reproducible targets and endpoints, not just to do some beautiful lines, some beautiful maps, and then we claim that we did atrial fibrillation ablation. Thank you.